Možda je klica ideje za romane Dana Browna posađena još u djetinjstvu kada je s ocem matematičarem misteriozne tragove otkrivao u popularnoj igri Lov na blago. Do danas su avanture profesora simbologije Robert Langdona, u kojima vješto razotkriva kodove i skrivena značenja, prodane u više od 200 milijuna primjeraka, prevedene na 56 jezika. Njegov je roman među 5 najčitanijih i među 10 najprodavanijih knjiga svih vremena. U crkvi je mnogo naučio od majke, glazbenice koja je izvodila pretežno sakralne pjesme. Diplomirao je engleski i španjolski i pokušao se baviti glazbom. Brownu se preokret dogodio nakon što je sa suprugom napisao vodič za žene frustrirane romantikom. Frustracija je rezultirala prekidom profesorske karijere i odlukom da se bavi samo pisanjem. 2000. u Anđelima i demonima, dr. Langdon kreće u spašavanje svijeta.
We are under attack from an old enemy.
Fine, Professor Langdon.
Langdon je spasio svijet i u sljedećoj knjizi, Da Vinčijevu kodu. I jedva smo ga našli. 2003. ova knjižnica u centru grada naručila je 6 komada hita Dan Browna, Da Vinčijev kod. 15 godina kasnije i dalje postoji lista čekanja za ovu knjigu. Roman je diljem svijeta prodan u više od 80 milijuna primjeraka.
Koliko god Amerikanci vrlo poštuju uspjeh, kritike Dana Browna u američkim novinama što sam ja čitala bile su vrlo pogubne.
Naljutio je i Vatikan koji je otvorio svoje tajne arhive i dao javnosti na uvid dokumentaciju koja opovrgava Brownove navode. Usput su zabranili da se film Anđeli i demoni snima u crkvama. Ipak filmovi se snimaju i vrlo su uspješni.
Evo sad ću se osramotiti, ja Dan Browna čitala nisam. Ostala sam na razini prelistavanja i nekoliko puta gledanja filma Da Vinčijevog koda, ali je pisan kao dobra napetica. Mislim, pa to onda ljude intrigira, ljudi koji vole trilere su oduševljeni. A možda ima nešto malo i neke teorije zavjera, pa im je to malo ovako in.
Slava, bogatstvo, visoka mjesta na ljestvicama čitanosti i na Forbesovoj listi bogataša nose i probleme. 2 tužbe za plagiranje. Obje odbačene. Nastavlja pisati. Slijede izgubljeni simbol Inferno.
Sad je izdao postanak. Moram priznati da mi je to ipak bilo puno zabavnije. Glavni junak mu je neki poduzetnik koji je kombinacija Steve'a Jobsa, Elona Muska i takvih likova. I bori se protiv tih nekih, nazovimo, nazadnjačkih ideja. I to je na kraju krajeva doista zabavno. To je ono provesti na plaži, na aerodromu, kod liječnika, bilo gdje. To je do dobro provedenih sat vremena. Mislim, to je, nije to toliko loše.
U Hrvatsku ga dovodi prvenstveno glazba.
Mislim da je glazba njegova prva ljubav i da je prilično slična njegovim romanima. Izravna, jasna i iznimno fokusirana na publiku.
Zato je sa Zagrebačkom filharmonijom dogovorio snimanje jedne njegove skladbe.
Pa je pitka glazba. Definitivno i orkestra se, ako se sviđa orkestra, onda znate da je uistinu dobra. Tako da veselimo se, već smo razgovarali o nekim novim projektima.
Do novih glazbenih projekata Dan Brown će i u Zagrebu promovirati najnoviji roman Postanak, koji je trenutno najprodavanija knjiga u Europi i SAD-u.
Poštovani gledatelji, dobar dan. Iz uvodnog priloga Maje Sever, naravno vidjeli ste tko je danas s nama. Pripremajući se za ovu emisiju, neposredno pred ulazak u studio, postavljao sam pitanja kolegicama koje su rekle Dan Brown ti je gost. Ja velim da. Pa znate li kolika je knjiga prodao? Pa vele, pa dobro, ajde, sigurno čim pitaš, vele, to su neki milijuni, 3-5 milijuna. Ne. Kao što ste čuli u uvodnom prilogu, čovjek je prodao 200 milijuna knjiga. Dobar dan, dobrodošli u emisiju Nedjeljom u 2.
Thank you very, very much. Pleasure to be here.
Prvo pitanje, što radite ovdje? Nešto smo načuli. Dosta je vaš dolazak u Hrvatsku bio obavijen velom tajne.
Well, I always travel in secret because I never want anyone to know what I'm researching. Mm-hmm. I was here for a number of reasons. One is my parents have been to Croatia twice and loved it, and they said, you must see this country, it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I also, my mother passed away last year, and I wrote a piece of music for her, an orchestral piece of music that I wanted to record. Mm-hmm. And I have a secret connection to the Zagreb Philharmonic, mm-hmm. and was very, very honored yesterday to have them play my piece. It was really exciting to be the only person in the Sinski Hall, sitting in the back row, mm-hmm. just listening to this wonderful orchestra play the piece. And that was very exciting for me.
Je li točno da se pjesma, u stvari, koja je izvodila Zagrebačka filharmonija, zove Goodbye?
It is called yeah. Goodbye. It's very bittersweet. My mother died of leukemia, and I knew she was dying. Mm-hmm. And it's a piece I started before she died. And I wish you could have heard it.
Koji je žanr pjesme koju je izvodila filharmonija? Je li to klasika, je li to moderna nekakva pjesma?
I would say it's modern, modern classical, I would say. So we'll see. At some point you'll hear it, I'm sure. But we'll, for the moment, we'll keep that a secret.
Moram priznati da sam se raspitao kao novinar među ljudima koji nešto znaju. Pohvalili su vas. Rekli su da su to čak sasvim dobre, na neki način, da ste sasvim dobru melodiju napisali, da to ima smisla, da to nije tek nabacano zbrda zdola. Tako da kažu da imate dara. Dobro, nije to vama prvi put, naravno, da pišete nešto tog tipa.
Yeah, this is not my first time writing music. No, mm-hmm. I've been doing that since I was a child.
Kaže Jonathan Franzen, također pisac, da je dobra stvar kod slavnih književnika, vi to jeste i on to jest, da ipak nisu toliko slavni da ih na ulici ljudi povlače za rukavi i žele se stalno fotografirati s njima. Je li to točno? Kakav vi dojam imate ovdje kad ste došli u Hrvatsku?
The wonderful thing about being a writer is that I'm not the celebrity. The book is the celebrity. If you're an actor or a musician, you are the product. Everybody recognizes you. But as an author, you can write the Da Vinci Code and still walk down the street with very few problems, mm-hmm. Which is wonderful. And I'm grateful for that. Writers are private people, generally. We work alone. Mm-hmm. We're not looking for stardom. And so it's nice to have some privacy.
Ovdje sam spomenuo sam Jonathana Franzena. Što mislite o njemu kao piscu? Volite li ono što piše?
Yeah. He's a phenomenal writer. I loved the corrections. Mm-hmm. I don't read a lot of fiction, and I haven't actually met Jonathan Franzen. I hear he's a very, very nice nice man, so maybe someday I'll meet him.
Da, imao sam tu čast da sam radio intervju s njim u tih 20 minuta što smo radili. Moram priznati da su i vaše zapažanja negdje na tom tragu dobra. Kad pričamo o slavi, spomenuli smo 200 milijuna knjiga. Ok, kažete niste toliko slavni da bi vas presretali na ulici. Ali kako se nosite sa tim uspjehom, sa tom ipak slavom? Jeste li kod sebe primijetili, možete li biti samokritični, jeste li primijetili da ste promijenili dio svoga karaktera?
You know, it's interesting. I remember after the Da Vinci Code came out and was so successful, I sat down to write my next book and I was having trouble. I would write a line and say, wait a minute, you know, millions of people are going to read that line. And I delete it. Wow. And I type it again. And I became very self-aware, which, of course, in the arts and in sports and in music is death. You can't be self-aware. Mm-hmm. If you are a musician who is thinking about every stroke on your violin, you can't play violin. Mm-hmm. It has to just flow. The same with writing, same with athletics. Mm-hmm. You have to be in that state of mind where it's just flow. And I remember this happened for a couple of weeks where I was having trouble writing. And I reminded myself, you've done this already. You know how to do this. You wrote 3 novels already. Mm-hmm. This is actually, I'd written 4 novels at that point. And I said, all you do is write the book that you would want to read. You just use your taste the way you always have. Mm-hmm. Write the book that you would want to read. And then just hope others share your taste. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what I did for the next book. And it was very successful. And but that was the only moment of change for me.
Znači, niste recimo primijetili kod sebe ono što kažu da je imanentno mnogim ljudima koji postanu slavni, recimo oholost, da ste bili u odnosima sa nekim bliskim ljudima pomalo drukčiji, da ste na njih ponekad gledali s visoka.
Yeah. You know, It's funny. The way I think about it, there's a great line in a song by Joe Walsh that says, "Everyone's so different, I'm still the same." Mm-hmm. It, my fame, if that's what you want to call it, does not occur to me. And it's interesting. For a year and a half after the Da Vinci Code came out, I was still driving the same rusted Volvo that I'd always driven. Mm-hmm. And people said, "Why don't you have a Maserati?" I said, "Well, it never occurred to me. It's not something that interests me." And when you're a writer, I learned very, very quickly that the process of writing doesn't change. It doesn't matter how many books you've sold. My characters don't care how many books I've sold. Yep. They still require my attention every day. I get up, I look at a blank piece of paper. Mm-hmm. My life is the same. The process is the same. And my close friends mm-hmm. are the same. They knew yep. me before the Da Vinci Code, and they know me now, and I forget. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, when I come to Croatia and I sit down and talk to a famous talk show host like yourself, it's like, "Oh, that's right, mm-hmm. I'm Dan Brown." Now and then I okay. have these strange experiences, but usually I don't remember.
You said something about Maserati and Volvo. Rekli ste da se vozite i dalje u starom Volvo. To je kao, na primjer, šef Ikeje. Ne znam da li znate, čovjek je isto multi... On je u stvari milijardera, vozi se u starom autu. Spominjemo novac. Kako novac utječe na karakter? Opet na vašem primjeru možemo govoriti. Dakle, mijenja li se karakter nešto uslijed činjenice da ste prodali 200 milijuna knjiga, jako dobro zaradili na njima, sudjelovali kao čovjek, kao autor tih knjiga u izradi filmova, yeah. također i tu zaradili?
Yeah, I don't think that there's a lot of change, to be totally honest. I really feel like the process is the process, the character is the character. I write about mm-hmm. a Harvard professor mm-hmm. who doesn't have a lot of money. Mm-hmm. What he has is an intellect and an intellectual curiosity. Mm-hmm. And that's what I have. I have a curiosity about art and science and the world. And so when my character moves through the world, he moves through the world as an intellectual, curious person, not as a wealthy person. The thing that does change is I have the luxury to travel the world and do research. The research really has changed. Because, for example, I used to go to a museum and not be able to see the secret stuff down in the basement, or not be able to talk to the head curator. And now, of course, I've been very, very fortunate. To. Mm-hmm. I just went to the Guggenheim to research Origin. I was excited to write about modern art because my character, Robert Langdon, knows about classical art. And I said, no, we're going to take him and put him in the world of modern art. And that was wonderful. I went to the Guggenheim and the head curator showed me around. And I learned about modern art from a specialist, which before I probably couldn't have done.
Sličan način ste koristili i za pisanje Inferna. Ako se ne varam, bili ste u Firenci, istraživali Firencu, njihove muzeje, oduševljeni ste s Danteom. Zašto ste oduševljeni s Danteom? Ajde da vas pitam. Mnogi su oduševljeni sa Danteom kao piscom, ali što je vas najviše impresioniralo kod njega?
Well, Dante is the original thriller writer. He was one of the first writers to write in a popular style. And he was criticized for it. But he was enormously popular because people would read this epic poem, The Divine Comedy, and they would see it reflecting their culture, reflecting their politics, reflecting their views of love, of sex, of heaven and hell, of religion. And so I had enormous interest in this transition from classical literature to popular literature. Of course, today we consider the Divine mm-hmm. Comedy, well, that's classical literature. Well, in its day, it was a thriller. Mm-hmm. And that's why so many people enjoyed it. And so that was one of the aspects of it that I loved so much.
Zašto katolička crkva može biti zahvalna Danteu?
How can they? I don't think the Catholic Church was particularly pleased by Dante.
Yeah.
it was funny because, there are scenes in his book when his political enemies mm-hmm. and his religious enemies are found in hell. Mm-hmm. There they are. And they're having to do these terrible tasks, or they're being whipped, or they're having to push rocks up a hill. And that's, Dante had the last laugh. He said, the pen is mightier than the sword. I'm gonna put you in hell and you're gonna be there for all of eternity in my book, whether you like it or not.
On je Dante u stvari prvi koji je napravio neku plastičnu sliku pakla koja je ljudima na neki način mogla tu imaginaciju koncentrirati i jednostavno ljudi su otprilike čitajući Dantea shvatili što bi pakao mogao biti i onda su tražili utjehu u crkvi.
Yes. You are right. That's an excellent point that the church owes Dante a debt of gratitude because you're right. Dante was the first to codify hell, to create an architecture, to create an image, a horrifying image of what hell might be. The Bible doesn't talk about hell very, very loosely. Dante was the first, and the picture of hell that he painted was so terrifying that a lot of people went to the church and said, protect me. All you need to do in church, like tell me how not to go there. I have to worship Jesus? Fine. I'm in. So you're right.
Ovdje smo uvodno malo razgovarali o vašim roditeljima, prvenstveno o majci. Otac je predavao matematiku. Je li što od te svoje, da tako kažem, matematičke preciznosti prenio na vas? Recimo, ja znam za detalj da je vama i vaše braće i sestrama ispod jelke umjesto poklona, ostavljao omotnicu sa zagonetkama. Yeah. Je li se to primilo očigledno kroz vas?
Yes. I mean, I had this amazing childhood. My parents were very creative, a lot of fun. And on Christmas morning, we would come down to the Christmas tree, hoping to find all of our presents. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Nothing under the Christmas tree. Just an envelope. And you open the envelope, and it's this difficult code. Or a riddle. Mm-hmm. And maybe, you know, we try to solve the riddle and maybe the solution is go look in the refrigerator. And you go to the refrigerator and open up and there's another envelope. Mm-hmm. And you open it up and maybe there's a math problem that somehow turns into a number, you know, that you solve another puzzle and you have to run up to the upstairs bathroom and you find another code. And then you have to run out to the garage to find another code. And finally it leads you to where all of your presents are hidden. And that, so for me, treasure hunts and codes and secrets were always fun. As a little kid, I thought codes, that's fun. Mm-hmm. And so I try to incorporate that in these books. And in Origin, as in Da Vinci Code and the other books, there's a treasure hunt. And you're trying to solve riddles in order to get to the end. And you know, these books are supposed to be fun. So that's why I do it.
Uopće vas više ni ne moram pitati, dakle, odakle vam simboli i zagonetke u vašim knjigama, ali još jedan podatak koji se odnosi na roditelje dobro vas oslikava na neki način, a to je da ste, kada ste primijetili, mislim da je Portland bio, a vi me ispravite, kada ste primijetili da ste prvi na New York Timesovoj top listi, prva stvar koju ste napravili bila je što?
First thing I did was I called my mom and dad. I care about them deeply, and we were talking earlier that when you're it doesn't matter how old you are, you want the approval of your parents. You want to say, look what I did. Mm-hmm. And that is something that we have as children. We want, especially if we respect our parents. As a kid, I always wanted my parents to be proud of me. And, you know, I'm sure your parents are proud of you, and that makes you happy. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter how old you are, how famous you are, how much you've accomplished. The first thing you do is you call your mom and dad.
Yes. Sad idemo na onaj neugodni dio emisije. Ovo je, da tako kažem, bio jedan lijepi uvod, ali neugodni i meni prvenstveno. Ali dobro, ja često postavljam u emisijama takva pitanja. Kritike. Ovdje ste spomenuli da naravno da želite da vas roditelji vole i da vi volite roditelje. Međutim, kako ste se osjećali u situacijama kada su neki od najznačajnijih američkih, hajmo se zadržati na američkim književnim kritičarima, o vašim knjigama govorili sve najgore. Yeah. Sad ne znam da li je potrebno da ovdje, da ovdje navodim citate, ali kako ste se osjećali u tim trenutima? Nije to bio samo jedan, nego dosta njih je znalo govoriti za ono što vi pišete, da ste grozan prozni stilist, da povijest književnosti ne pamti tako lošu literaturu, etc. etc.
You know what? It hurts. I'm not going to lie. It hurts. You want everyone to love what you do. And I know we're supposed to say, I don't read the critics. It doesn't bother me. It hurts. Of course it does. When you are a creative person, whether you're a musician or a chef or a painter, you wish everyone loved what you do. Mm-hmm. That's not the way the world works. Everyone has taste. And what I've come to understand is that I just write to my taste. I write the book that I would want to read. Some people share my taste, other people don't. And that's just the way it is. And it's the way it is for every creative person. And I have learned early on, I got good advice. I was told, ignore your critics, but also ignore the people who praise you. You have to ignore both. Because if you listen to your critics who say you don't know what you're doing, you become insecure, you second guess what you're doing, and you start to lose your own voice. And if you listen to the people who praise you and say, you are the best, you're number one, I love what you do, you get lazy, you get complacent, you start to think, I know exactly what I'm doing. And the truth in life is that we don't always know exactly what we're doing. We're doing our best. And so I put on the blinders, and I just go ahead and I don't listen to people saying you're number one. I don't listen to people saying, please don't write another book, we hate you. And I just do what I do.
Jeste li nekad sreli te kritičare, face to face? Je li kome neugodno, njima, vama? Kako izgleda taj susret?
They are always embarrassed. It's the funniest thing. So I was in Milan at the Prima della Scala. I had been invited to the opening of opera season. And we're all dressed up, and I walk in, and who am I sitting next to but Umberto Eco?
Oh.
Okay? He is not a fan of mine. He said some very, very bad things about me. And I walked up to him, and I shook his hand. I said, Mr. Eco, I know you're not a fan of mine, but I'm a fan of yours.
Fine.
And he just melted. He didn't know what to say. What do you say? He knew all the terrible things he'd said about me. And I actually am a fan of his. I think he writes some fascinating things. So anyway, it's all just about taste.
Vi i ja se ne znamo, nikad u životu nismo razgovarali, sad smo se prvi put vidjeli. Ja moram priznati da ostavljate dojam, ne znam jeste li to, ali ostavljate dojam relativno skromnog čovjeka. Moram priznati da mi je malo iznenadio odgovor koji ste mi dali na ovo pitanje, da vas pogađaju kritike i da biste, u stvari najviše mi se svidjelo ovo što ste rekli, da biste željeli da vas svi vole. A to je nemoguće, mislim to.
I wish I were, it's impossible.
Da. Jednom prilikom ste izjavili, kad ste govorili o svojim knjigama, da želite pisati knjige koje... To me začudilo, nisam shvatio što ste htjeli reći. Želite pisati knjige koje imaju okus sladoleda od vanilije, ali su hranjive poput povrća. Je li to moguće?
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I thought one of the nicest compliments I was ever paid was by an old woman who said, you know why I love your books? They taste like ice cream, but they nourish me like vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
So she was trying to say, I'm learning, but I'm having fun. And to me, the best teachers, and I think teachers are heroes. I think teaching is the noblest profession on earth. I think that one of the big challenges, especially in my country, is education. That we need a better education system.
In our country too.
Everywhere. Yes. It's the single most important thing that we can pass on to our children, to educate them. And so I wrote a hero that's a teacher. Robert Langdon is just a professor. He's not a CIA operative or an astronaut or some famous anybody. He's a teacher, the greatest of all heroes. My father was a teacher. He's a hero to me. So when somebody says, your books teach me and I'm having fun, I say, I've done my job.
Ovdje ste spomenuli Roberta Langdona, glavnog junaka vaših knjiga. On ne voli kravate. Ne znam.
He does not like ties.
Ne znam je li ih vi volite. On kaže na jednom mjestu da ih smatra minijaturnim omčama oko vrata. Kaže da zna da potječu od nemilosrdnih četa hrvatskih plaćenika koji prije nego što su išli u boju da bi ih stavili oko vrata. To progovarate vi kroz Langdona?
maybe.
Da?
I love Croatia.
Dobro.
I'm not a big fan of the cravat.
So... Upravo zato mi smo pripremili jedan poklon.
Oh, my word.
Za vas, ovo je izvorna hrvatska kravata. Nosite
this,
je ili
this
ne.
This one I might wear. Beautiful. Thank you. And actually goes with what I'm wearing. Look at this. This is the first tie that I will have worn in many years.
Okay, it will be a pleasure.
Thank you very, very much.
I wanted to stavite unutra.
That is great. Thank you.
Što mislite o Tomu Hanksu koji utjelovljuje Roberta Langdona?
Yeah.
Jeste li zadovoljni s njime u toj ulozi? Yeah. Jeste li ga upoznali privatno i kakav je ovako?
Well, of course. I mean, I mean, Tom Hanks is one of the greatest actors on earth. I'm honored that he would play Robert Langdon. I can tell you, I've spent a lot of time with him, and he is one of the nicest, most humble, hardworking people you can imagine. I mean, he's a superstar, but when you watch him interact with anyone, and I mean even a waiter in a restaurant, mm-hmm. he is kind, he's humble, mm-hmm. he's funny. You also forget that he got his start in comedy. And so he's one of the funniest mm-hmm. people I've ever met in person. And also just highly intellectual, very, very professional, as is Ron Howard. Both of them are really amazing individuals.
Ovdje prije nego što sam ušao u studio, a spomenuo sam to i uvodno, sam razgovarao sa nekim kolegicama koje su rekle, joj, pročitale smo Brownovu knjigu, odlična je, ali filmovi nam se ne sviđaju. Jeste li vi zadovoljni filmovima koji su snimljeni prema vašim knjigama?
Yeah, you know what I'm most pleased about is that Ron Howard protected the heartbeat of each book. Now these books are very hard to adapt. Mm-hmm. They're long, there's a lot of history. Mm-hmm. They don't make movies easily because so much has to fall away. And I think that's the frustration of some of the viewers, that they know the book and the book feels like this and they watch the movie and it feels like this. If they didn't do that, if they didn't compress the action, the movies would be 10 hours long. So I look at the movies as a different telling of my book. It's Ron Howard's version of my story. And it's my hope that someday, mm-hmm. And we're working on this now, we can launch a television series about Langdon, where the first season, 12 episodes, is the telling of the lost symbol. And the second season, 12 episodes, is the telling of origin. Mm-hmm. So rather than 2 hours to tell the story, we have 12 hours. And then it can be much, just much more like the books. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To je vaša ideja ili mm-hmm. se neko drugi došao?
Yes.
A vaša je?
Yeah, it's a bunch of people had the same idea.
Okay. Zbog onoga što pišete i zbog knjiga o kojima razgovaramo, bili ste često napadani od različitih religijskih grupa. Jeste li vi religiozan
sure.
čovjek?
I started out as a religious person. I would say I'm a spiritual person today. I grew up in a very religious household. My mom was Christian. My dad was Christian. Mm-hmm. My dad moved away from the church. He's much more of a rational. He's a mathematician. But my mother was deeply spiritual. She played the organ at church. I sang in the choir. I went to church camp. I read the Bible. I was very religious. And it was funny that when I was about 13 years old, I learned about evolution. I believed in Adam and Eve and the story of Genesis in the mm-hmm. Bible. And when I was about 13, I was at the Boston Museum of Science and saw an image of apes evolving into people mm-hmm. and learned about evolution. And I went to my priest and I said, wait a minute, which story is true? And this priest said, nice boys don't ask that mm-hmm. question. So, of course, I'm angry. Mm-hmm. I'm a child. It's like, I want an answer. Mm-hmm. And at that point, I really moved away from religion. And I moved into science. And I studied a lot of science, a lot of math, a lot of physics, a lot of particle physics, sort of. And the farther I reached into science, the more it started to circle back. And numbers became imaginary numbers. And you started to read about phenomena in the subatomic realm where physicists were saying, they were having religious experiences, saying the world isn't as we thought it was. There's something else happening here. And you come all the way back into this world of spirituality.
Mala digresija, i onda vam Welbeck ukrade naslov knjige i nazove elementarne čestice.
Yes, he does.
Okay.
Fair enough. Yeah. And so what I've really come to understand is that science and religion are two different languages trying to tell the same story. And I know this is a very Catholic country, and I grew up Episcopalian, which is very, very similar. I have no problem with religion and the Bible and these stories. What I've come to do is to view the Bible as a collection of beautiful fables, myths, stories that can teach us something. I do not believe the Bible is literal fact or that it came from God divinely. That's just me personally. A lot of people believe that. I think the danger of religion is when we start to look at our mythology and call it fact. Say, this isn't a story. This is true. This really happened. And if you don't believe this really happened, you're going to hell. Or I want to hurt you. That's really where the danger comes. We have these ancient scriptures in many, many religions from which we can learn. And we can learn about ourselves. We can learn about our history. But the day we sort of say, this is absolute fact, anyone who does not believe like we do is an enemy, that's when we run into problems.
Da, to ste u pravu. Metafore u religijskim knjigama često se upotrebljavaju kao neko gorivo za širenje zla, mržnje, ubojstva i slično. Možete li zamisliti svijet bez religije? Vi ste pisac, imaginirate. Jeste li došli u tu fazu imaginacije da možete zamisliti svijet u kojem nema religije?
Sure. I can very easily imagine a world without religion because I've been to countries without religion. I have a lot of friends who are atheists who function perfectly well. I think that we are spiritual creatures. Just if we don't have religion, it doesn't mean that we don't have appreciation for everything we don't understand. And that's what religion is really trying to do. It's trying to give us answers. What happens when we die? What are we doing here? These are questions that religion asks. And religion is, in my opinion, presumptuous enough to give answers. To say, you want to know what happens when you die? You go to heaven. And Jesus is there, for example. Why are you here? You're here because you were created by God in his image. I can imagine a world very, very easily where we respect those questions. What happens when we die? I guess we'll find out. And that's part of the mystery of life. Why are we here? Maybe it's just physics and chemistry and we got lucky. We landed on a planet that was the right distance from the sun and we had plants just grow and then we were here. Or maybe there's a divine creator that we can't begin to imagine.
Mislite li da se društvo razvija u tome smjeru? Da ide, recimo ovdje spomenuti malo prije Welbeck, u svojim knjigama prognozira, to je isto fikcija, ali prognozira nekakav takav svijet. Mislite li da svijet ide u tom smjeru?
I strongly believe that we are moving in a less religious direction. I don't believe it's a less spiritual direction. I believe we're asking the hard questions, but we're starting to look elsewhere for the answers. We're starting to look to science. We're starting to look to each other. We're starting to look to the study of the human mind to find the answers. And I've often thought, what happens if in the future we are able to temporarily die? You know, you have people who are on an operating table, die for 60 seconds, they're brought back to life, and they say, the strangest thing happened. This was my experience. What happens if in the future we're able to die for 10 minutes or 15 minutes and be brought back, and we really experience death? And what happens if the stories that are coming back are not corroborated by religion? If they say, no, I know what the Bible says, that's not what happens. Mm-hmm. What happens in that moment? Those are questions that I think a novelist, I won't write about that, but somebody could write about it. It's a fascinating question.
Yes, it is.
If the answers to these big religious questions start to appear.
Kad govorimo o svijetu bez religije, vi govorite i o znanosti, može li se u takvom svijetu računati sa etikom? Dakle, religija ipak dobar dio svog, da tako kažem, poslanja propagira na etici i činjenici, ajde da govorimo o kršćanskoj religiji, ne učini zlo drugome, ne učini onome što ne bih htio da se tebi čini. Znanost ne daje odgovore na ta pitanja. Ono što vas želim pitati.
Yes.
Neki kažu da će eventualno u svijetu bez dominantnih religija taj moment biti zapostavljen, da će ljudi biti manje empatični, manje suosjećajni. Ovo nije moje mišljenje, ali iznosim mišljenje nekih drugih ljudi.
It is a fascinating question. And as I say in Origin, religion has done a lot of good in the world. It provides an architecture for ethics and morals. Mm-hmm. It provides a support system for people in need. Maybe you're somebody who is very unhappy in your life and you get out of bed and you think, how do I go on? Mm-hmm. You say, I go on because God's helping me, because there's somebody looking after me, that this is all part of God's plan. It serves a purpose. An atheist would argue, wait a minute, As far as ethics goes, I don't need the Ten Commandments to know thou shalt not kill. I learned at a young age that I want to treat others the way I want to be treated, because if I don't, they're going to hurt me. So I don't think that religion has the market cornered on morality. I think that there's something inherent in our DNA that provides morality. And you look at a little child, even a little kid, who sees a worm on the ground and knows not to step on it. They know to pick it up off the road and put it on the grass and say, good luck. That's not religious. That's humanity.
Da, mogli bi pričati sad ovdje i o etici sljedećih 20 minuta do kraja emisije, ali nećemo, zato jer ima još drugih tema. A s obzirom da ste čovjek koji je prodao 200 milijuna knjiga i s obzirom na činjenicu da se knjige sve manje čitaju, opet neću pametovati i reći da mislim da je to, zgražati se na time, reći da mislim da je to dobro ili loše, nego ću odgovor ostaviti vama. Je li to dobro ili loše što se knjige sve manje čitaju? Kako u Hrvatskoj, tako
It's terrible.
Da?
Terrible.
Zašto?
For many, many reasons.
Why?
You know, books, the process of reading stimulates your imagination. Uh-huh. Listen, I love movies, I love TV, I enjoy them both. It's a different experience.
One digression. Je li točno da vam roditelji nisu dali da gledate televiziju dok ste bili mali?
I had no TV growing up. They said, you have to read books. You have to develop your imagination. Mm-hmm. And it was funny because when I went to school and all the kids were saying, oh, did you see that show last night where this happened and that happened?
Da.
I had no friends. I couldn't talk to anybody. but it's true. I didn't have TV. I stimulated my imagination. And my parents now tell me, oh, you always complained, it worked out okay for you.
Da.
So they get the last
one. Da ste vi roditelj, biste li upotrebljavali takvu tehniku ili biste ipak bili malo milosrdniji, da tako kažem, prema djeci?
I would probably be slightly more merciful. There would be limited television. The process of reading is very, very different from watching a movie. If you watch a movie, the scene, for example, in Origin, set in the Guggenheim Museum, you just see it. You absorb it through your eyes. If you're reading the novel and you're saying, okay, the Guggenheim Museum is that big, it has 37,000 titanium tiles and it looks like a dragon on the side of a river, and it's this museum where the steps are all uneven, you have to actually physiologically in your brain, something happens. You physiologically have to create a mental image. It strengthens your brain. And it makes you think differently. And it's interesting to me that I think that the world is changing very rapidly, and I think a lot of it has to do with the generation of technology, that we are all connected to each other very, very quickly. We have no attention span.
Kakvi ste vi s tehnologijama? Jeste li ovisnik o Facebooku, Twitteru, Instagramu ili ipak to držite na nekoj distanci?
I keep it at a distance because I know my personality. I'm an addictive person. I write books. You have to be a compulsive person to sit down every day and write a book. I also think that Facebook is an illusion. You say, I have, 6 million friends. No, you don't. No, you don't. It's funny. What I see in the world, and this is a line from Origin, that a priest says, 30 years ago, we were all looking to the heavens. And now we're looking down into our phones. You walk down the street, everybody's like this. You go to a doctor's office, everybody's waiting like this. Used to be reading a book or talking to somebody. And the amazing thing is, and we've all felt it, and I feel it, if you haven't checked your email for an hour, you're like, oh, geez, I should probably see what's happening in my life. That's an addiction. That's a compulsion. My fear is that this digital technology, which does unite us in some ways, also creates barriers. And you see this with kids. I've had parents who say, wow, our kids in the back of the car sure are quiet. They're texting each other. They sit next to each other and send each other texts. It's like, you've got to learn how to interact, how to make eye contact, how to talk, how to feel that human connection. Yeah. That's really my fear with technology.
Mislite li, s obzirom na ovu temu o kojoj govorimo, da će jednog dana nestati knjige kao takve ili će se unatoč ovome nadiranju novih tehnologija, knjiga kao, nemamo je ovdje, ali kao papir, kao nešto što možemo opipati i slično, i dalje zadržati, omirisati, što je jako važno.
Yeah. As a paper artifact, I don't know about a paper artifact, but books, absolutely. writing and storytelling is the oldest art form on earth. We would sit around fires and tell stories, even if we're pantomiming, just showing how you killed a woolly mammoth or whatever it is. Telling a story, this is what happened to me, and you tell the story. The art of storytelling will never, ever disappear. We may get to the point where we function only with digital text. That's possible. I don't, you know, I prefer original, just normal text book with paper, but that's just me. And when I travel, I might at home be reading a book in front of the fire. I'm turning the pages and I'm halfway through and I've got to leave. And I pick it up on my iPad and I just keep reading. And, you know, for the first second, you're like, oh, I'm reading a digital book. And then you forget. You're just reading text. I don't have a problem with the digital format. In many ways, the digital format is allowing publishers to distribute books to people who maybe are too far away for the truck to get to the bookstore, or maybe they can't afford a $20 book. So digital publishing has its benefits.
Dolazite iz multikulturalne sredine Sjedinjenih država. U Europi se mnoge države boje u posljednje vrijeme dolaska izbjeglica, odnosno različitih ljudi od nas, kakvih jesmo, u te naše sredine. Kako ste vi kao dijete, a kako i danas, doživljavali ljude druge vjere, druge nacije, druge religije? Je li to nešto što ste naučili od roditelja ili ste taj odnos sami razvijali?
I see them as my teachers. I see them as people from whom I can learn. I was very, very fortunate as a child. I grew up on the campus of Phillips Exeter Academy, which is it's a boarding school, a very famous boarding school where my father was a professor. This school has students from all over the world. I forget how many countries, but from all over the world. So I grew up in a dormitory with people of every color, every religion. And the church on the campus, they taught, you know, Christianity, Islam, transcendental meditation, Judaism. And so I just sort of, that was my childhood. My first babysitter was from Kenya. I grew up in a mixing pot. And so I actually, it was not until I left that environment and went to university, I had no idea there was prejudice. I had no idea that people didn't like people of different colors or different religions. It made no sense to me, and it still makes no sense to me.
Evo, spominjete sredinu u kojoj su se ljudi miješali, u kojoj je bilo ljudi svih nacija, vjera i tako dalje. Što mislite o trenutačnom odnosu vašeg predsjednika prema imigrantima, dakle Donalda Trumpa? Kakav je to odnos, od udara ili on od ovoga stajališta koje vi ovdje propagirate?
I think it's important as an American to remember that your country was built by immigrants, that we are all immigrants. And that while it is very, very important to protect your country, and clearly there are problems in every country, you know, it's not an immigrant problem, it's a population problem, is what it really is. If you have too many people come into your country, it poses economic problems. And it was all well and good when the people coming into the country were building skyscrapers. Then immigrants are great. And now all of a sudden it shifted. I tend to believe that if you're the big kid on the playground, if you have some power and you have some good fortune, that it is your moral responsibility to help the person who doesn't. The person who maybe got beat up by somebody else on the playground and needs help. That's my personal belief.
Što mislite inače o Donaldu Trumpu i o činjenici da je on vaš predsjednik, da vas predstavlja?
We have recently celebrated Independence Day in the United States, a very big national holiday. I'm very proud to live in a country, and I'm going to rewind. I'm not a big fan of Donald Trump. I didn't vote for Donald Trump. I don't know anybody who voted for Donald Trump. I disagree with many, many things that he does. I disagree with a lot of his methods. At the same time, I'm proud to live in a country where I can come on the biggest television show in your country and say, I don't agree with the American president. I can go on the biggest show in my country and say, I am not a fan of Donald Trump, and I'm fine. I live in a country where I'm allowed to do that. Mm-hmm. I live in a country where I'm allowed to write a book that is critical of our number one religion in our country. And it sparks a debate, and we have an intellectual conversation about it. I'm not thrown in prison. So I may say right now in history, I'm not a big fan of the president, but that will change. He'll come and he'll go.
Dobro, ali što onda možete, ja bih vaš volio da ste mi rekli da ste suzdržani ili da ste ga pohvalili, ali preformulirat ću pitanje koje sam imao. Što biste onda mogli poručiti onim sunarodnjacima, a prisjećajući se Dantea i onoga što je on pisao u svojoj božanskoj komediji, a to je da su najmračniji kutevi pakla rezervirani za one koji ostaju neutralni u vremenima moralne krize. A vremena moralne krize možda bi se mogla u ovom trenutku primijeniti i na Sjedinjene Države.
Absolutely. So the first thing you say is, if you didn't vote, you can't complain.
Da,
okay,
da,
that's
dobro.
The first thing you say. You know, we have a saying in English, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Mm-hmm. Okay. If you're not taking action to be part of the solution, then you're part of the problem. You can't be complacent. You can't sit on the sideline and complain. And so what I see a lot of my compatriots doing, people who may disagree with political policies, is going out and, for example, the arts have been, their funding for the arts in the United States has been cut drastically under Donald Trump, just has. These people are going out with their own money and their own time, their own energy and saying, we need to fund the arts. That's being part of the solution. I think that a lot of people have woken up and said, oh, and by the way, I should say, this is not a U.S. problem or a U.S. situation, a U.S. phenomenon. This is a global phenomenon, yes. Nationalism.
Yeah.
And I think that in this day and age, I believe it is a reaction to the shrinking world. Technology has made the world tiny. And all of a sudden, we're in close contact with our neighbors. We didn't used to be.
No.
You know, we now are a global community. And I think this nationalism is a reaction to that. Like, wait a minute, this is mine. Mm-hmm. And this is what I believe, and these are my borders, and you stay there.
Hoće li taj nacionalizam napredovati, progresirati, mijenjati oblike i biti sve jači i jači, ili mislite da je to vječna borba, da tako kažem, između s jedne strane ljubavi za sve ljude, a s druge strane ipak ljubavi, da tako kažem, za svoje pleme?
Yeah. I think that, I mean, the tribal concept, that this tribal idea of humanity is shrinking. Right now, we're with a pendulum swung all the way over here. Mm-hmm. It will very, very quickly swing back. We are, if you just look at what the human species looks like, mm-hmm. 50 years from now, mm-hmm. we are much more homogeneous, okay? Because yeah. all the races, the ethnicities, mm-hmm. they're intermarrying. We're having mixed children, mixed families. These walls are going to fall, and we will become a global community. We'll realize that what it means to be American or Canadian or Mexican or Croatian is not as different in 50 years as it is today.
Dobro, ali vi ste optimist. Vi predviđate neku dobru sliku svijeta. Može li se dogoditi poput onoga što se dogodilo, imaginacija je to naravno, ali u vašem infernu? Dakle, da porast stanovništva jednostavno dovede do velikih problema. Dakle, vi sure. predviđate neku pozitivnu, optimističnu sliku razvoja situacije na yeah. zemlji. Danas nas ima 7-8 milijardi. U infernu se, yeah. se barata sa brojkama koje su više milijardi i koje jednostavno na neki način prijete kataklizmom yeah. zemlji.
There is a cataclysm. Fortunately, I'll just rewind. As far as being an optimist, the reason I'm an optimist is that I truly believe that I don't wear rose-colored glasses. I know the world has a lot of problems. And when you ask me about Trump and immigrants, an impossible situation. It doesn't have a clean answer. Mm-hmm. So it's very well, I can say, well, I think we should help everybody. You know what? It's not that easy. I understand that. As far as the future, I'm an optimist because in my experience, there is infinitely more love on this planet than there is hatred. There is infinitely more creative power than destructive power. And as our technologies progress, yes, we are going to use artificial intelligence to kill people. Mm-hmm. Because that's what people do. When we invented fire to cook our food, we said we can also use it to burn down this village and take all their things. We invented nuclear power, we said, great, now we can make weapons. We use technology in war to take what we want or to protect ourselves. So this will happen. But what will happen even more so is that we will use the new technologies to solve the problems of the future. Problems of pollution, problems of not enough food, problems of overpopulation. And that's what Inferno was about. Inferno was about a brilliant man who said, you know what? We're all going to die. And I'm going to take control and sterilize the planet.
Ovdje ste spomenuli jednu lijepu, važnu, premoćnu riječ ljubav. Beatles je isto tvrde da je ljubav sama po sebi dovoljna. Međutim, ima i drugih koji kažu da ne, da nije to tako. Pa ću ovdje spomenuti jednog cinika francuskog koji kaže da je kapitalizam ubio ljubav. On kaže da je ljubav i opasna i nasilna i nepredvidiva i da je kapitalizam stvorio slobodni seks da bi uništio ljubav. Jel se to, mislim, to se referira vjerojatno na 60. i 70. seksualnu revoluciju.
Yeah.
Jel se to događa? Mislite li vi da je to tako ili ne?
I concur with half of it. I think love is dangerous and it's impulsive and you can't control it. Love is of the heart. You can't control who you love. You can't control who you don't love. Love just happens. And it's very, very powerful. And it's illogical. It's emotional. Capitalism killed love? Absolutely not. That doesn't make any sense to me. Capitalism has nothing to do with love. There are plenty of capitalists who are deeply in love. Maybe they're in love with money, but they're deep. No, I'm kidding. No, but they're in love. I don't see any connection between capitalism and love. And you know, free sex, I don't think there is free sex. I mean, sooner or later you realize that you need love. That it's a shallow, it's people who chase lust or people who chase money only will quickly realize, no, that in itself is not enough. There's a reason the suicide rate is highest in the 1% population of the income bracket. That if you say, I'll be happy when I have money, and you finally have money and you're not happy, there's nowhere else to go.
Yeah.
If you don't have money and you're hopeful, say, well, I'm not happy today, but maybe when I have this, I'll be happy, you can keep going.
Jel vi to govorite iz vlastitog iskustva? Jeste li vi ikada bili bez novaca ili su vaši roditelji ipak bili relativno imućni?
No, we didn't have much money when I was growing up. My parents, my dad was a school teacher, my mom was an organist. We cut coupons out of the newspaper to save 25 cents on a gallon of milk. Later in my life, my father became very, very successful as a writer. And then we had money. But we grew up knowing the value of money.
Završit ću emisiju sa prisjećanjem na imao sam nedavno razgovor s jednim divnim čovjekom. On je baletni koreograf, Hrvat je, ima 90 godina, još uvijek se bavi svojim poslom i on kaže da se u svojoj 90. godini raduje životu. On kaže da se danas, kad sjedne u svoje dvorište gdje raste jedno prekrasno drvo, on ne može načuditi tom drvetu da gleda drvo sat vremena. I da tako može gledati sve stvari. Kakav je vaš pogled na život? Nalazite li se negdje u ovim riječima?
The beauty of old age is that you begin to appreciate everything you've taken for granted. And that's because you have learned. You've learned what's important. And as a kid, you don't know that tree is important. At an older age, you can appreciate it. My father is 82. He recently lost the love of his life, and he could be crying. This man has said, you know what your mom would want me to do? She'd want me to live. And he is out looking at the tree and playing tennis and being with friends and enjoying music and enjoying art, seizing the moment. And I think we have a lot to learn from a 90-year-old who can appreciate something as simple as a tree.
Hvala vam na ovom razgovoru. Želim vam ugodan ostatak koji ćete provesti u Hrvatskoj, da opet dođete u Hrvatsku ovom ili onom prigodom ili zgodom. Svaku dobru u životu, evo što drugo da vam kažem.
Thank you, it's a great pleasure. Nice to meet you.
Također, poštovani gledatelji, bilo je to sve za danas. Vidimo se za tjedan dana. Do tada, doviđenja. We'll be right back.